willingly agreed to give us a lecture this evening on issues that are very relevant to the Coast and Coast Week's activities. If you don't know what Coast Weeks are, it's a statewide celebration that goes from September 17th to October 10th. I have a calendar of Coast Week's activities in Massachusetts. There are walks, there are beach cleanups, there are all kinds of activities that are going on throughout the Massachusetts coastline over the next few weeks. So if you are interested in more information, please feel free to contact the Sea Grant office here in Woods Hole or consult the newspaper here. And it has some other ideas for how to celebrate a celebration of our coastline. Well, this evening, to kick off this celebration, I'd like to introduce Rocky Geyer, who is an associate scientist in the Applied Ocean Physics and Engineering Department. And this evening, he'll be discussing, look what the currents dragged in, coastal currents and their effect on marine debris. Rocky?
Thanks, Judy. That's a really wonderful title that I didn't come up with, actually. That's Tracy Crego's creation. But she knows better than I do. So. Okay, I'd like to start out by, for those of you who aren't intimately familiar with Woods Hole, and even those who are, just to, by way of explanation, to let you know that Woods Hole is famous for its blue water oceanographers. These illustrious and highly intelligent scientists who go out in large ships into the pristine blue water and study fascinating phenomena in the ocean, like submerged volcanoes and the Gulf Stream and whales and famous ships that have sunk. But when they want to find somebody to talk about sewage or garbage, who do they call? Bob Ballard? Now they call me, so I'm your trash talker. So I'd like to start out by showing you some stuff on trash. Let me see, right. I think this will be the right one. Do we have the lights down? Well, maybe I'm going backwards. Okay, here's some trash. Gotta bring my notes with me. Yeah, trash is pretty ugly, and it's really one of the unattractive aspects of civilization, that we end up despoiling our environment. In some cases, it has really lethal or at least strongly deleterious effects on the biota. This is an example where some fishing gear got tangled up with a seal, and or sea lion, and caused the in this case, the photographer hopefully rescued the seal, but the in some cases it can lead to death of the of these marine organisms. And in some cases, this is as you may recall, about 5 years ago there was some medical waste that started washing up in New Jersey. And about 2 weeks later, I got a call from the a reporter from the Vineyard Gazette, who told me that there were similar medical waste washing up on South Beach. That's where these came from. And he wanted to know whether it was possible that they could have originated it from the same source as the waste that were observed in New Jersey. And as I get through the talk, you'll see that that's a reasonable scenario. In fact, it's pretty clear that the it's the same source, and these medical waste traveled actually 150 miles from where they were dumped off the New York Bight to the to South Beach in Martha's Vineyard. So it gives a sense of the scope of the problem of marine debris and how it can be traveled, how it can be carried around in the coastal environment. Not all debris is directly of human origin. This is Phaeocystis, which is a type of actually harmless or relatively harmless phytoplankton, but which in large doses makes a mess of the beach. And so this is, although it's not pollution per se, it's certainly aggravated by the input of nutrients into the coastal ecosystem. And so indirectly, it's associated with the activities of man. And certainly the fate of this kind of organic debris is similar to the fate of the traditional trash that we normally think about. And so so the fate of this kind of substance depends on the same processes that as the fate of the other kinds of floating debris that, that might be thrown out of boats and that sort of thing. Another example of an organic debris is this type of seaweed. This is a picture on the beach in Nahant. This is called paella, and it's a type of seaweed that grows in such incredible abundance that the beach just gets this 1 foot thick layer of muck on it, and it stinks so badly after a while that they try to plow it all up and dispose of it. So so these are a couple examples where possibly nutrient enrichment in the environment is leading to the accumulation of floating debris which accumulates on the beaches. And so what I'd like to do now is to, can I have the lights back on? Is to basically lay out what the, generically, what the components of pollution problems are. First we have sources, and then we have transport. And we have impact. So I've been showing you what the impacts of marine debris are. First, I'll briefly discuss sources, and then I'll get into transport. Of course, we all know where garbage comes from. It comes from New Jersey. No, exit 7 or exit 8. No, actually, it doesn't come from New Jersey. It comes from everywhere. And for instance, back in the old days, people didn't really care so much about the environment. They used to throw garbage overboard from pleasure boats. And in some cases, fishermen, usually not intentionally, may lose their gear over the side, and then it gets caught up in marine mammals that are trying to swim around or in fish. So these are unintentional forms of abuses to the environment. Now, it used to be that garbage was dumped offshore in not very far from shore either. Even when I was a kid, they used to have garbage barges that would go out in the middle of Long Island Sound and dump the trash. This is a garbage barge heading down the Hudson River, and it's actually not going to dump it offshore. It's going to dump it on Staten Island. But it used to be that this was an important and conspicuous source of marine debris. And finally, there's sewage treatment plants, which don't really provide a source of marine debris anymore, because assuming that they're working properly, because they screen out the chunks of tampon applicators and whatnot, so that they aren't going to make it into the environment as long as the system's working properly. We all know about combined sewage overflows, which are bypasses from sewage systems in particularly in old New England cities, and these provide a direct conduit for some debris to get into the marine environment. But we're getting better, and you know, if we spend enough billions of dollars, we can basically take care of this source of pollutants too. So by and large, the sources of marine pollution are decreasing due to improved technology and improved public awareness. But there's still a lot of garbage out there, and it's still getting sloshed around in the marine environment. And so the main focus of my discussion tonight is to look at the mechanisms that that are carrying that garbage around in the marine environment. And I'm going to focus on the New England waters, because I think that's something I know more about than other places, and I think it's something that it's an area that you're probably more interested in than elsewhere. So, so let me know what I'm supposed to do. Oh yeah, let's get back to that medical waste problem. This is a schematic. This is not the actual trajectory of the medical waste, but the We know that they started somewhere off the New York Bight and were first located, were first found washing up near Sandy Hook in New Jersey. And then about 2 weeks after that, roughly 3 weeks after they were probably dumped, they showed up on South Beach in Martha's Vineyard. And so the question is, how did this debris get from the New York Bight to Martha's Vineyard? And before I became an oceanographer, when I knew a little bit but not much, I would have said, well, it's probably the Gulf Stream, because the Gulf Stream goes that direction, and so that probably carries the water along the coast. But if we look at where the Gulf Stream is, this is a nice picture of the Gulf Stream. The Gulf Stream is this purple region. It's easily identifiable by a sharp change in temperature from the cold shelf slope waters along the New England coast to this much warmer water, which is at the edge of the Sargasso Sea. And this strong temperature gradient is also a region of very strong velocity. So if you get out here, the currents are actually going as much as 3 knots towards the northeast. So that would be the right direction to be carrying our marine debris. But actually, if you look at where the anomalies, where the structure of the Gulf Stream is, it's about 300 miles from the coast. And in fact, the Gulf Stream has very little effect on the currents. It has virtually no effect on the currents on the New England shelf. Occasionally, we get these warm core rings which penetrate up to the edge of the shelf break. But they, because of some laws of physics that are very hard to understand, they don't penetrate onto the shelf. So it's not the Gulf Stream that's pushing the water around, and that can't explain why these needles managed to make it all the way across 150 miles along the coast. Well, what's a more likely explanation has to do with the effects of winds blowing on the surface of the ocean. Now, when the wind blows on the water, it exerts a stress, just like the stress that's exerted when I push my hand on the table. I'm not strong enough to move the table, but that's the same idea. So when the wind exerts the stress on the water, it puts the water into motion. And the very near surface water basically goes downwind. But as we penetrate further into the water column across the region, which is called the surface mixed layer, which is a region that's subject to a lot of turbulence due to the wave and wind action, As we move downward across this mixed layer, the current actually rotates to the right. The reason it rotates to the right is because of the effect of the Earth's rotation. And the average over the region where the wind is pushing on the water, the average direction of the flow is actually exactly 90 degrees to the direction of the wind. And that would be in a region where we're not near any boundaries. So if we're not near any boundaries, then we blow the wind this way, and the water moves exactly to the right of us. It's a very peculiar effect, which is due to the fact that the Earth is rotating. The water is trying to go straight, but the Earth is rotating while it's moving. And the Earth is rotating relatively to the left, which leads to this apparent rightward motion of the water. So this rightward rotation of the water is called an Ekman spiral. And the transport that's associated with the wind is called Ekman transport. Well, the very surface water doesn't move 90 degrees to the right of the wind. It actually moves maybe 20 or 30 degrees to the right of the wind. And the measurements are actually very difficult in that very thin surface layer of water. And a good way to find out is actually to see where things that are floating on the surface go. Although things that float on the surface don't behave exactly like water. So it's a little bit tricky. But in any case, they go almost downwind, but not quite. They go slightly to the right of the wind. And typically, the wind pattern in the summertime in the New England area is dominated by the Bermuda High, which leads to southwesterly winds. So the winds typically in the summertime are blowing in this direction. And in fact, during this period, between when these medical wastes were dumped and when they were observed in Martha's Vineyard, the wind, we had one of those typical high-pressure systems where it's sunny every day and a little steamy, and the wind comes up every afternoon. And so that was a period where we had persistent southwesterly winds for the three-week period where this debris was cruising across. So if the wind is coming in this direction, and we figure that the surface current's going about 30 degrees to the right of the wind, it's about right. And it explains the trajectory of this debris. And someone put together a really fancy numerical model to hindcast that it, in fact, this debris really did go from this region to Martha's Vineyard. But I think that this simple explanation is about as effective and as accurate as that fancy numerical model was. But given the fact that we know very little about the variations of the wind field, but assuming that it's roughly southwesterly. So in this case, we have a pretty good idea of what caused the motion of the of these near surface drifters, essentially. Now I want to talk a little bit more about some other effects of the wind, because I think wind effects are really quite important and one of two of the most important things that affect marine debris. The next thing I want to talk about is a phenomenon called upwelling, which most of you probably have some idea about. If we consider a bay, like let's say Buzzard's Bay. There's Nawshawn and Cuddy Hunk. That's Woods Hole, I guess. And let's consider the typical situation where the southwesterly wind is blowing into Buzzard's Bay. Okay, now the wind is exerting a stress on the surface of Buzzard's Bay, so it's pushing the surface water into the bay. Okay, well, what's going to happen as it pushes the water into the bay? The water's going to start moving. Now, you've got to forget everything I just said about Ekman transport, because in this case, the water wants to go to the right, but it runs into Nawshawn Island and starts piling up on Nawshawn Island. Well, that straightens it back out again. So actually, in this case, because we have boundaries on Buzzard's Bay, the water actually just keeps going straight up the bay. But it doesn't get up very far before the water up at onset starts piling up. And so that's what's called setup, which means basically that the water just starts piling up, so that if we had a tide gauge there, we'd see that ignore the tides for now, that we'd see that the sea level was getting higher there. Okay, if we take a slice through the this is the top panel is a slice through Buzzard's Bay, and we have this wind that's blowing up the bay. Now the water starts piling up at the upstream end of the bay. Okay, and as it piles up there, it's just intuitively you know that if the water level's higher here than it is here, there's going to be a tendency for it to flow back downhill again. Okay, well, in the surface water, we have the competing effect. There's the direct effect of the wind blowing on the water. But that effect of the wind diminishes as we go further into the water column. And by the time we get down into the deep water, this water doesn't feel the wind at all. But it does feel the tilting of the water surface. So it feels the fact that it's higher over here than it is over here. So the deep water responds to that tilting of the water, which is called a pressure gradient. Basically, you can describe the effect of this tilting of the water by changing the pressure. That at the same level down here, the pressure's higher than it is over here, and the water tries to relieve that pressure by flowing from high pressure to low pressure. So that pressure gradient drives the flow in the seaward direction at the bottom while it's going in the landward direction at the surface. And so we end up with a circulation going on, in at the surface, downwind at the surface, and back upwind returning in the deep water. Now, when you consider the fact that the Buzzard's Bay is actually U-shaped rather than being flat, there's actually some variations, some subtlety to this. But we don't have to worry about that right now. The basic picture is that that we have this return flow that's going underneath the surface flow. Okay, well, if you consider garbage that's floating around on the surface, you can see what's going to happen to it. It's going to all end up up at Buzzards Bay or at Onset. Because anything that floats is going to be carried landward with the surface current, but it's not going to sink when it gets to the beach. It's just going to wash up on the beach. In fact, the waves and the breaking waves and the flow associated with them helps push the material up on the beach. And so you can see that a downwelling situation is a good way of collecting garbage. It's a very effective way of trapping the garbage. So this process is like a conveyor belt to carry all the garbage right up to the head of the bay and leave it there. And the basic reason why it stays there is because the garbage doesn't follow the water. The water goes down. It comes back this way. But the garbage doesn't. And nor do organisms that float. So if we have organisms like some kind of plankton that likes to float, it's all going to accumulate at the head of the bay. Okay, if we turn the wind around now, we have a northerly, northeasterly wind blowing down Buzzards Bay. We can see that we just reversed the whole picture. And now we have an upwelling situation. Now we're pulling the water down. This is called set down. And now the pressure gradient reverses, and we just reverse the whole picture. So now we're pulling cold water up, and we're pushing the surface water out. So when we have a northeasterly blowing, now the Buzzard Bay gets very clean at the northeast end of it, and it blows all the seaweed and garbage out to sea. Well, most of it out to sea. Some of it gets hung up on Penzance Point. I used to live out on Penzance Point, and when northeasters blew, we'd get about a foot of seaweed piled up on our beach. I mean, it's amazing. And it's just because this is a very, if you're on the downwind end, it's a very effective trapping mechanism. Anything in the water, it's like a filter. It just takes everything in the water and puts it on the beach. Okay, so this is the simplest upwelling, downwelling scenario. Well, I should just point out that if you're a swimmer, you can see one of the effects of upwelling is that the water's cold. Typically in the summertime, the water's stratified and it's warmer at the surface than it is at the bottom. That's what this variation in color represents. And so in Buzzards Bay, there's not too much difference. It's probably a couple degrees colder, a couple degrees centigrade colder at the bottom than it is at the surface. It's probably 65 degrees Fahrenheit at the bottom. So if you have an upwelling situation, you're going to cool the water off at the upwind end of the bay. And the stronger the stratification is, the more noticeable that effect is going to be. Okay, now if we consider coastal upwelling, this is a little more complicated. And now we go back to the situation where when the wind blows, the water moves to the right of the wind, the Ekman transport situation. And the reason why the Ekman transport applies in the coastal situation when it doesn't apply in a bay is because on the coast, when the wind blows along the coast, there's no boundary out on this side. And so the current is free to push up against the coast. And when it gets to the coast, it has to do something and turns around and comes back down as shown here. But we don't have a similar constraint on the other side. And so the dominant effect of the wind in a coastal situation occurs when the wind is blowing along the coast rather than across the coast. So we have a different situation in coastal upwelling than we do in upwelling and embayments. And so the strongest effect of upwelling in a coastal region is when we have along shore winds. Okay, and the sense of the along shore wind that affects upwelling and downwelling. On an east coast situation, a northerly wind, a wind when you're looking towards the coast from land, when the wind is going to your right, that's going to cause downwelling. And it's if you think of how the Ekman transport goes with respect to the wind, the Ekman transport goes to the right of the wind. And so when the wind blows down the coast, it's piling water up against the coast, the Ekman transport is. Okay, and as it piles the water up the coast, it pushes it down, downwelling situation. If we have the reverse situation, southerly winds, or around here, southwesterly winds, don't think about Buzzards Bay now. Think about the coast of New Hampshire or Maine or something like that. So southwesterly winds, the winds blowing along the coast, pushing the surface water offshore due to this Ekman transport that pulls the cold water up, pulls the surface water offshore. Okay, and another effect of this is where we start getting into more of the subtlety of it, is as it pulls the water up, it's causing the sea level to come down. And as the sea level comes down, it drives a geostrophic flow. Now, geostrophic flow means a flow that represents a balance between pressure gradient and the effect of the Earth's rotation, the Coriolis effect. And that geostrophic flow is a flow which is directed in the same direction as the wind. So at least it's in the same direction as the wind. So that part's pretty simple. But it's not a direct effect of the wind. It's actually an indirect effect of the wind associated with the fact that the sea level has set down. So these flows are very complicated, and I had a lot of trouble understanding them when I was a student. So I don't mind if you're confused too. But in any case, the upshot of it is that when the wind blows from the south, we get upwelling. And when the wind blows from the north, we get downwelling. If we went to the west coast, we'd have to reverse those. If we went to the southern hemisphere, we'd also have to reverse those. But since we're not either on the west coast or the southern hemisphere, that's the basic story. Okay, so now to give a more concrete example of this. This is a surface temperature image from satellite during the summer of 1990 in Massachusetts Bay. Here's Cape Ann and Cape Cod, and here's the coast of New Hampshire and the beginning of the coast of Maine up here. And the orange and yellow are warm, and the blue is cold. So what we have here is a southwesterly wind. This is sort of typical summertime conditions. Now, in the region where the wind parallels the coast, I mean, one difference between the east coast and the west coast when we're considering upwelling is that the coastline orientation varies all over the place. So you don't get this really simple picture in east coast upwelling. But there's some regions, like along here, where the coast is approximately parallel to the wind. And then up here, it's also approximately parallel to the wind. Okay, and in those regions where the coast is approximately parallel to the wind, we get very intense upwelling. We get much colder water at the coast than we do out in the middle of the bay. Typically in the middle of Massachusetts Bay, the water, well, in this case, it gets up just about to 20 degrees. And at the edge of the bay, it gets down to, well, I guess the minimum at this time was about 14 degrees centigrade. So there's a really striking temperature gradient across this this region. And we get this thin region of upwelling along here, which is upwelling more like embayment-type upwelling, where the wind stress acting exactly across the coast causes some offshore transport of the surface water. But the most intense upwelling is the upwelling that occurs when the wind is parallel to the coast. That's much more effective than the little strip of upwelling that we get due to the wind straight offshore. Okay, one thing that's really interesting about this, and that I didn't really realize until I started seeing this, I always assumed that the reason, I think a lot of other people assume too, the reason why Cape Cod Bay and Massachusetts Bay are so much colder than Buzzards Bay and Nantucket Sound is because of the Labrador Current and it just being a different water mass, water coming from the north. But if you look at this, you realize that the water in much of Massachusetts Bay is actually quite warm. Just the water that you feel when you go down to the beach is cold. And in fact, the difference in temperature out in the middle of Massachusetts Bay is really not that great between from Massachusetts Bay down to Buzzards Bay. It's a few degrees colder, but not that much colder. The main reason why Massachusetts Bay has such a bad reputation, and for that matter, the Gulf of Maine as well, is because of upwelling. I mean, we get very persistent upwelling during the summertime, which makes the water much colder along the coast and makes us think that the water in Massachusetts and Cape Cod Bay is very cold, when in fact it's only sort of cold. Okay, and now I'm going to get into a more regional picture. I'm going to shift gears and leave the issue of wind-driven motions for the time being and get into the regional circulation and how that relates to fresh water, inputs of fresh water. This is a map of, well, you can probably figure out what it's a map of, New England and Nova Scotia, New Brunswick, Newfoundland. And it's showing the extension of the coastal current that starts off the coast of Labrador. So maybe this is the Labrador current. There's actually a couple physical oceanographers here. Does anyone know what, Phil, do you know exactly what the Labrador current is? Is that a coastal current? Okay, this is the Labrador current. It originates in Labrador and comes down. But the important point here is this is a coastal current. It's a current that's very close to the coast, and it hugs the coast right around, even going around Newfoundland. And one thing you notice about all these arrows, or almost all these arrows, is that if you're standing at the coast looking towards the sea, the current is going to your right. And that's true virtually everywhere that you would stand here, virtually any of these coasts. You see, the current is always going around to the right, to the right relative to facing the sea. Okay, this current is associated with a variety of freshwater inputs. One of the freshwater, the original freshwater input is Hudson's Bay. There's a lot of rivers that drain into Hudson's Bay. In fact, they're doing a lot of hydroelectric projects up there right now. And that water from Hudson's Bay comes around the coast of Labrador and drives this coastal current, which splits and goes around Newfoundland. And then this is a very large source of fresh water. All the fresh water from the Great Lakes comes out the Gulf of St. Lawrence. So this is a maybe third or fourth biggest river coming out of the out of North America. So a very large source of fresh water. Comes all the way around Nova Scotia and continues this coastal current into the Gulf of Maine. Okay, now there's several medium-sized rivers that come into the Gulf of Maine, the last one being the Merrimack. So there's a number of freshwater sources here. These all contribute to this coastal current. And then this coastal current continues. Not much more happens in the way of sources, but the coastal current keeps on going and goes out the southeast channel, but some of it goes around George's Bank. Okay, now the mechanism of driving this freshwater flow is associated with the density difference between freshwater and seawater. Now the freshwater is being driven by gravity down the river. That's basically why rivers flow, is because they're going downhill. Okay, now when they get out into the ocean, they don't generally mix, or they don't mix completely. They retain some of their brackish quality. They don't attain the salinity of seawater. They have slightly less salinity. And this brackish water comes out, and because it's less dense than seawater, it slides over the oceanic water. And as it comes sliding over the oceanic water, it doesn't go straight out to sea. It turns to the right, just like the water in the mixed layer that's being pushed by the wind turns to the right. Everything turns to the right. Basically, if you give something enough time, it'll turn to the right. If you roll a bowling ball down a very large bowling alley that doesn't have any friction, eventually it'll turn to the right. It would be a very large bowling alley because it would take about 4 hours for it to. So you'd have to roll it very slowly, and it'd have to be a very large bowling alley. But it would turn to the right. And by this, think of this as bowling balls coming out. They're turning to the right. And the reason they're turning to the right is because the Earth is rotating underneath them. And in 4 hours, the Earth rotates enough so that they turn about 90 degrees. That's somewhat of an oversimplification. I didn't expect any physical oceanographers to be here. But it's a fair approximation of what the mechanism of this turning is. So due to the Earth's rotation, the water turns to the right. Okay, this is a cross-sectional view. We have this lens of fresh water, which is overlying high salinity water. It's not fresh, actually. It's been mixed by tides and waves that are breaking and various other processes which provide turbulence. So there's some mixing, but it's still less dense than the underlying seawater. And so we have this plume of less dense water, which is sliding over the oceanic water. Okay, the details of the dynamics of this current are pretty complicated. There's a pressure gradient. The sea level is actually higher at the coast than it is offshore. And that slope of the sea level drives the current in under the influence of the Earth's rotation. So that's part of the dynamics of it. There's some friction, and there's significant influence of winds. So this picture that I'm describing is a case that would happen if there weren't any wind. When you start blowing wind, you start getting variations on this picture. But the basic concept is valid in the no wind case. And then when we start putting winds on it, we can start varying it around. But this is the basic concept where fresh water comes out and drives this coastal flow. And if we have lots of rivers, then these coastal plumes coalesce with each other, and it generates that pattern of circulation that we saw, starting with the coast of Labrador and cruising all the way around into the Gulf of Maine and then out past Massachusetts Bay. And there's one example that I'd like to show you of this coastal current, which is data that was taken from a project that I'm working in collaboration with Don Anderson and Rich Signell and Brad Butman, the latter two at USGS, and Don Anderson in the biology department here, on the coastal current that originates from the discharge of the Kennebec-Androscoggin rivers, which is right here, and where there happens to be, or it's believed to be, a seed population of red tide organisms. These red tide organisms cause toxicity of shellfish along the coast, extending as far as, in fact, in one particularly bad year, as far as Sandwich, but particularly through this region. And so this red tide problem motivated this study of the coastal current, and Don Anderson and a student of his, Peter Franks, who an ex-student of his, came up with the plume advection hypothesis that the coastal current provides the mechanism of transport of these red tide cells to contaminate, to cross state lines and contaminate other areas. And the USGS collaborators and myself are interested in the physical dynamics of this plume structure and basically what factors influence the propagation speed and the mixing processes in this coastal plume. But this is an example of the plume when it's in its fullest development, the largest density anomaly between the ambient waters of about 33 parts per thousand and the plume waters, which get down to 28 parts per thousand. Actually, they get even lower than that, right in the vicinity of the mouth of the estuary. So this is one segment of this larger scale coastal circulation, which is going all the way around from Newfoundland down to Cape Cod. So this is one of the last freshwater inputs of a long series of freshwater inputs. Here's another one. This is a little bit of the Penobscot discharge. Most of the Penobscot discharge, we believe, went out this way. There's no data out here, by the way. This is the Merrimack discharge, which for some reason was fairly diminutive at this time. So the dominant feature right at this time is the Kennebec-Androscoggin plume. But they all blend together and provide this mechanism of coastal transport. All right. Okay, now, this is just a prototype of a holy sock drifter. It's not the type that we actually used in our study, but one of the ways that we observe the magnitude and character of the currents in the Gulf of Maine is to put drifters with drogues that look something like this. They have hoops and some kind of cloth that connects the hoops together. And the idea of these is that they move with the water. And this particular one is about 2 meters long. And we put some of these drogues in the top 2 meters and some of them over the top 10 meters to observe the trajectory of the currents in this coastal current and in the surrounding areas. In fact, I had done an earlier study in Massachusetts Bay where we used similar drifters to observe the circulation patterns in Massachusetts Bay. And I'll show those data too. The drifters had a surface float which had a radio transmitter which communicated with the Argo satellite and provided position information and environmental data like salinity and temperature. Oh, that's right, this is a view graph. Okay, so here are the results. This is actually a composite of most of our drifter results from the last 4 years. The light blue, let me get this right. Now, the magenta was 1990, the light blue is 1991, and that was part of the Mass Bay program. The green was 1993, and the red is our latest stuff in 1994. And so what we see, okay, that in the Mass Bay program, the drifters were released right near the new outfall site, the sewage outfall site from Boston. And except for one of them, which was released off the mouth of the Merrimack. And in the 1993-1994 deployments, they were all released right at the mouth of the Kennebec. And the pattern of virtually all the drifters is to follow this pattern of the coastal circulation. And then when they get, they may or may not come into Massachusetts Bay. But once they get into Massachusetts Bay, they all leave just to the north of Provincetown and hook around the tip of the Cape and then zip down the outer edge of the Cape. The highest speeds that we observed of all these drifters were right here in this region, just east of Provincetown. And then once they get past there, they either go east towards George's Bank or head on around Nantucket Shoals and back to the west. You can see there's a lot actually in this figure. There seems to be a trapping zone right in the middle of Cape Cod Bay. This was a one of the things that's very deceiving about drifters is that they don't represent a time average of the flow. You tend to look at drifters and say, well, I guess that's the way the flow goes. Well, that's the way the flow went that time. And if you put in another drifter a week later, it'll do something totally different. And likewise, as you, so you need, you actually need lots and lots of drifters to get a really clear picture of what the circulation is. In fact, Phil Richardson in the back of the room has done many drifter studies all over the world, and the power of his results come from averaging many, many drifters. And this is way too few to get a clear picture of the structure of the flow, but it gives us a hint as to the structure of the flow. But in any case, this trapping of water right in the middle of Cape Cod Bay was pretty interesting, and we believe to be the petering out of this coastal current as it comes down. The coastal current was quite strong as it was carrying these drifters into Cape Cod Bay, and then that was pretty much the end of the runoff for that season. And these drifters got into the middle of Cape Cod Bay, and the plume lost its steam, and they just stayed in Cape Cod Bay for the next month or so. And actually, once they got into Cape Cod Bay, subsequent drifters didn't go into Cape Cod Bay because there was a pool of warm, low salinity water sitting in Cape Cod Bay, which acted as a barrier, which kept more drifters from going into Cape Cod Bay. So the rest of them tended to come down and go around. Okay, well, the data that we have from the Gulf of Maine coastal current shows that, in fact, we haven't had any drifters go into Massachusetts Bay since we started the study of the Gulf of Maine coastal current, which is not to say that the water doesn't. We know that the water does go into Massachusetts Bay. We had one drifter go in, but it wasn't transmitting. But somebody found one of our drifters in Massachusetts Bay. And one of these drifters that we released in 1991 did make that turn into Massachusetts Bay. So the fate of these drifters depends a lot on what the wind was doing when the drifter was out there. And so this particular drifter, this one that made it into Massachusetts Bay, as it was going past Cape Ann, the wind started blowing from the northeast. And that pushed the drifter right into Massachusetts Bay. And so the fate of these drifters depends to a large extent on what was happening at the time that they were out there. Some of these zigzags, the large zigzags that we see here, are the strong tides in Nantucket Shoals. And there's some other large zigzags out here, which are the tides on George's Bank. And one thing that provides you with is a sense of what the importance of the tides is. The tides, most people when they think of what moves things around in the marine environment, think of tides. It's usually the first thing they think about. And that makes sense if we're thinking of small embayments, particularly mudflats and that kind of thing, where the tide is by far the dominant mechanism that's carrying water in and out. But you can see once we get to large scales, the tides actually have a pretty minor influence on the fate of the material. It causes the material to jitter around, the trajectories to jitter around, but it actually doesn't have much much effect on their ultimate fate. In fact, this one drifter was trying to get in and out of Nantucket Sound as it was passing the mouth of Nantucket Sound. Tremendous tidal currents in the vicinity of Pollock Rip, but there's no mean, or there's very little mean associated with the tidal current, so it averages out, and over several days, the net effect of the tide was pretty minimal, and the effect which really determined the fate of these drifters was actually the larger scale, slower but more persistent circulation associated with the coastal current. And I just want to point out from there was a famous oceanographer, in fact I work in the building named after him, Henry Bryant Bigelow, who provided his estimate of the regional circulation of the Gulf of Maine based on drift bottle studies and I think ship drift measurements. This was done in the near the turn of the century, and this is the schematic that he came up with of the circulation in the Gulf of Maine. And basically, we don't have anything to refute his diagram. In fact, it's amazing how faithful our drifters are to his observations. The only part of the only circulation pattern that deviates slightly from Bigelow's diagram is this little segment in here where we had one drifter that was going against the prevailing flow. And I don't think that's because Bigelow's diagram is wrong. I think it's just because this particular period was a period of very strong southwesterly winds, which established an Ekman drift in the direction that opposed the prevailing coastal current. And so I think actually even some of the more, what I thought were more imaginative details of this circulation pattern seem to be borne out by our drifter trajectories. So I think that basically means that we haven't learned anything in 100 years. No, that isn't what it means. We have a much more sophisticated way to verify these brilliant deductions of earlier oceanographers. Okay, I'd like to summarize now, just run through some of the key points. And the first one is that the circulation of the New England coast is not influenced by the Gulf Stream. We pretty much don't have to worry about the Gulf Stream when we're thinking about the circulation of the New England coast. We can't attribute temperature anomalies to the Gulf Stream because that just can't make it into the shallow water on the continental shelf. The mechanisms that drive the motion tend to be either wind-driven or associated with the coastal currents that are driven by freshwater inputs that come from the various rivers, the big rivers to the north and the medium-sized rivers in the Gulf of Maine, which contribute to this regional circulation that Bigelow came up with so well in the early 1900s. However, that circulation pattern is perturbed by the episodic wind events that can make the currents at any given time zig and zag in various different directions. The coastal upwelling provides a mechanism for producing pretty large temperature anomalies in the coastal zone, and it also has a big effect on where garbage is going to end up, because we see that the if we're at the upwelling side of a bay or a coast, we're going to have a clean beach, and if we're on the downwelling side, we'll have warm water, but it'll probably be pretty dirty. So the what's the significance of all this? I think that what we're trying to do as physical oceanographers is to come up with a better quantitative representation of how material gets transported in the coastal ocean so that we can better manage the impacts and minimize the impacts of undesirable introductions to the environment, whether they be natural ones such as the red tide organisms or anthropogenic ones such as the introduction of medical waste. one thing that the transport of both the medical waste and the red tide organisms shows us is that pollution in the marine environment is a regional problem. It doesn't respect state lines or international borders. And the transport pretty effectively carries waste and the beneficial resources of the marine environment across borders, and makes the whole problem inherently one continuous, one integrated whole. So I guess on that note, on that rather fractured note, I'll end with a sunset. Thanks. Questions? We have 1 minute for questions. Well, I guess in the case of the medical waste, that was a way of confirming that there probably weren't two sources, you know, that there weren't two places along the coast where contaminants had been dumped. One thing that is fairly common is for the Coast Guard to give us a call and ask us to help in search and rescue operations to try to hindcast if they find some, or if they know that a ship was issued a mayday at some location where they might be, which is a little different from the general problem of marine debris, but it's certainly related. In terms of the smoking gun of pollutants, when I've been involved with some litigation, for instance, in New Bedford, the PCB problems there, and one of the big issues when you look at the distribution of contaminants, trying to figure out whether it's either possible or likely that when you see contaminants in a certain region, whether they originated at a certain source. I mean, you know where the sources are, you just don't know which ones contributed to the degradation in a certain environment. So that's it's a very contentious game because, well, particularly when there's lawsuits involved. The lawyers make all the decisions, the scientists have very little to do with it.
Does the canal have any impact on the drift in Cape
Breton? It has a pretty small effect. I think that there's probably a 5 kilometer region around the mouth of Cape Cod Bay where there's probably a temperature anomaly associated with the warm water that gets transported through. But there's, even though there's very strong tidal currents in Cape Cod Bay, the net flow is quite small. It's partly as a result of the tidal currents. The tidal currents generate a lot of turbulence, which prevents the pressure gradient. There is a pressure gradient across the canal. It's a little higher on average on the Cape Cod Bay side than on the Buzzards Bay side. But the strong tidal currents keep that from being a conduit for a major amount of flow. One thing that canals tend to do is they provide a way of that organisms can get between two areas. They don't tend to have as big an effect on the water properties, but they have a big effect on the biodiversity, on the actual genetic communication between different regions. In the case of, it's not a severe problem in the case of Cape Cod Bay and Buzzards Bay, but something like the Suez Canal, then you're talking about a pretty major effect. Okay. Hi, Rick.
How shallow would you expect to see excellent flow? Would you see it in the shallow bays along the
No. The it's surprising that the Ekman layer can be very thin in Massachusetts Bay because we had very strong stratification in the surface waters. But there's a couple of factors that keep us from having Ekman turning in the small bays. One is that if the if we're not very far from the coast, then the water can't be transported very far before it starts setting up pressure gradients, which suppress the Ekman transport. So part of it has to do with the horizontal scales involved. And then the other factor is whether the friction of the wind is communicating all the way to the bottom. And if we're in a situation where the turbulent mixing and the friction that's associated with that extends all the way to the bottom, then the dynamics change, and we no longer have a balance between the inertial forces of the water and the stress. We now have the bottom stress getting involved. So I'd say that's a long-winded answer, basically. Probably not. Drogues are part of drifters. Drogues are also sometimes called sea anchors. So the drogue is the thing that attaches the drifter to the water and makes it move around. So it's the cloth thing that hangs down underneath the drifter. Yeah. Sure.
Does that step up and step down? Is that what explains the sand leaving the beaches of the upper Pleasant Bay in the summertime and returning in the winter?
Probably not. So it actually, which beaches?
Well, up in Monument Beach area, the shellfish are much deeper in the winter.
Shellfish are
much deeper. And on the beach.
Yeah.
Look at that flow from the northeast wind bringing, in other words, to its shore in the upper, under the, the underwater.
Yeah, but I would have thought it would, I'm just looking at my accurate map here, and, I would have thought it would push the northeasters, unless you happen to be in a place which...
You got a southwest wind in the summertime that's driving your bottom water.
Yeah, but I would think that first of all, I should say that that what moves sand around is waves, is waves, pure and simple. That's it's all what's called littoral drift, which is when waves crash into a beach, there's a flow field, which is set up by the dynamics of the waves as they, basically what's happening is the waves lose their momentum as they come up on the beach, and they transfer their momentum to the water, and if the waves are coming in at an angle to the water, then they transfer their momentum and cause a longshore flow. And so this is something I'm sure you're familiar with. If you have groins, like breakwaters that come out, and we have waves coming in like this, what you're going to see is the sand is going to pile up on this side of the groins. And so, and this sand piling up on this side of the groins is because the wave momentum is coming like this. The longshore component of wave momentum is being transferred into a longshore flow. And if you go out, you notice it more on the West Coast where waves are bigger. But if you go out on a beach when the waves are coming at an angle to the shore, and you go out just in the vicinity, just inshore of where the waves break, there'll be a strong longshore flow. And that longshore flow is associated with the momentum transfer from the waves into the flow. And so that's, if you can use a concept like that to invoke the transport, I'd believe that. But in terms of the upwelling, downwelling, basically that mechanism provides a long distance transport, but it doesn't provide a very energetic one. In order to move sand around, you need a lot of energy. And so that's why waves are really the key to I don't know. It could be, but I would think it's more likely wave dynamics. Anything else? I guess I'm off the hook.